I can't wait to make this video, which is why I jumped on it this morning. Happy July 1st to all of you viewers, as well as all those who are not viewing but receiving it telepathically, right through just the deep mind transmission, which is everyone. We're in my time of year now, the summer. We've got three summer months, July, August, September. And so right on cue, tremendous boost. So we have a fabulous news for everyone. I'm in a super great mood this morning. I feel great, and with good reason, with really good reason to feel that way, actually. So we get everyone to kind of settle in. I'm on a wow high, so to speak. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow. So, right on cue, I've been told, given that I'm right on track and deliverance is coming just as expected. It will come right on track for that. And then here we go with July 1st. I woke up from a nightmare, kind of, this morning. And what happened was, in this nightmare, I was in the kitchen. And I suddenly looked up, and I saw all these spiders with all these huge webs. It spun webs all covering the light in, up above, the light in the kitchen. There's all covering up there. And we had been walking through the kitchen, and we hadn't hit the webs because the webs had kind of spanned out. And so we could still walk through the kitchen, but they were covering the light and making it blurry, you know, it wasn't clear. I said, oh my gosh, I'd never seen this before. All this time, there's all these big spiders up there, these terrible spiders are spinning these webs. I was shocked by it. And I said, okay, I got to do something. So I got this spray, spider spray. And I came in, I said, we got to clear this out. And so I sprayed the spiders. And then I got this dust kind of wand and cleared all the cobwebs, all their webs out of the kitchen. And then I said, I've done it. And I went in the kitchen, I was looking up the lights like I've done it. And suddenly I saw this huge spider walking across the ceiling. I said, huh? It was the mother of all spiders. And where did this one come from? I didn't get that one. And she must have been in hiding. It was the mother of all spiders. And so I rushed and I got the spray and I sprayed the mother of all spiders. And that was it. And then I woke up from the dream, like, oh. Like, it was so intense. The mother of all spiders was part green and part russet color. And I understand now, after getting some hindsight on this, of what it's about. The other spiders were kind of russet colored, like the color of dry grass. You know, when the spring comes and the grass is green, it's all lush and green, but then it withers and dies, right? And it gets this russet kind of brownish russet color, yellowish. You know, the color of dried grasses, kind of. And so this spider was a mixture of that. And now I realize it was the mandala of life and death, this big mother of all spiders. And the other spiders were the individual spiders of individual lives. But this mother spider was the archetype of the whole mandala of life and death. Really, it was a death mandala, producing forms to die. And I finally sprayed that mother of all spiders, and she there's no more. So quite a daring thing, right? Quite a daring thing. Okay, so then I'm trying to go back to sleep. And very shaken up by the whole experience. But not too bad. I kept saying, I got to get my mind off this. Wow, 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 what an experience. Wow, 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 wow. So I finally did get my mind off of it. And what happened next is what I will describe as a frame of reference shift. I shifted into what I will call mandalic consciousness. The mandalic perspective. Mandalic perspective. Mandalic consciousness. And I suddenly didn't see myself as some person in a world. I saw myself like in the center of this vast circular wheel-like mandala. And I was looking down upon this mandala. I was like on a height, kind of like in the hub, the center of this vast mandala. But I was up at some height looking down upon 360 degrees about this flat mandala. And it was the mandala of death that I was looking down upon. And I saw it all as one flat circular mandala. And I saw it as the mandala of transmigration. The vast mandala of transmigration. Not just this world, but all the afterworlds and all other worlds. It's a circular transmigration. I saw all of it as one. And I saw, and I realized what it's about. It's all attempting to fixate, to stabilize hallucination. Okay, so I was able to see it, but and then I was able to see, I was in what's called mandalic consciousness. I was able to see everything instead of like I'm a person in a point in time here in this world. I was able to look down and see all of the different stages of transmigration as we go round and around in this circle from this life to the afterlife to other aspects of the afterlife to other births, etc. All in the same moment, I saw it all as just this vast mandala. So I realized I had shifted into mandalic consciousness. All praise to Manjushri and the mandalic apex array. Okay, Manjushri, the great Bodhisattva Manjushri, who really appeared as Buddha, appeared as Longchenpa, and appeared as these great transmissions of mandalic consciousness to the world, to us. When we're projecting as if we're a speck of consciousness in a body on this vast wheel of transmigration, but we're really the consciousness that is above all this, looking down and seeing it all as one. That's the real consciousness we are. So that's mandalic consciousness. So Manjushri, the Bodhisattva Manjushri, has transmitted this mandalic consciousness to the world in so many, many ways. That's why I'm wearing this apex yoga shirt. Thank you, Jimmy, for that. And so we're shifting down into this mandalic consciousness, and I realized that the new way practice is the practice that enabled me to make the shift. Okay, it will enable us to make this shift as you practice devaluing the I, which we've done for about the last almost month. I've been doing it for the last month, and it only took a month before this shift into mandalic consciousness. But I've been after it very, very intensely, very, very intense month. The month of June was a transitional month of super intense practice. I had a little vacation at the end of May that primed me for this great push. As I'm able to make this tremendous push, so we shifted into mandalic consciousness. Thank you, Longchenpa. Longchenpa, 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 absolutely. And then, after I shifted into mandalic consciousness and was aware of this, then this practice came to me, which is to say, the grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow. And I realize that this is a super practice. You know, it is just, I always call it the highest practice, most the highest practice we've gotten to. And it's a tremendously high practice and effective practice. So we're giving it out today, July 1st, giving it out today to everyone. to everyone, all beings in the that imagine themselves to be somewhere on this wheel of transmigration, this vast mandala of death, transmigrating through this mandala of death, the wheel of transmigration, life death, which is trying to stabilize really hallucination, the absence of reality, is attempting to fixate the mind. We won't get into that. We've gotten to that many times. We'll see how that unfolds. But so this is being transmitted to all who imagine themselves to be some entity, some being, some individual, some person within this vast mandala of transmigration. Death transmigration, really. We're really saying to hallucination, hey, hallucination, look what you're creating. You created all of this, so you must be a creator. But the fact is that the mind is both hallucinating the absence of reality, as if it were a new reality, and at the same time hallucinating this vast mandala of transmigration. Both, it's hallucinating both, but then claiming that the hallucinating the absence of reality is causing this vast wheel of transmigration, as if it's causative of that, and we're trying to convince ourselves that this is true, but we're really hallucinating all of it simultaneously. So hallucination is not causative at all, but we're trying to make it causative by this hallucinating this vast wheel of transmigration, of death forms transmigrating into death, and there's this vast wheel, mandalic array, 360 degree, as we go, with many vast possibilities, so many different combinations of death. Trying to say, look, hallucinating the absence of reality. You're really the new reality. And yeah, you're based on death of the old reality. So you're new creation of death, but you are you're causative of all of this. And not true. We're imagining it. The mind is imagining all of this simultaneously. It's all just an effect of the mind. Okay, it's not an effect of a new reality, a hallucinating the absence of reality, a new reality. At all. Hallelujah. So, the grace of God is shining, the grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it is vastly better than expected. Wow. Do just that practice. And if you can't do this practice, then you go back to the devaluing the I. You can do them both. You know, they strengthen one another, you might say. I'm just showing you what the devaluing the I practice will get you to, is you will be able to shift into mandalic consciousness. So this is my first experience of mandalic consciousness, and I had no idea. I had never aimed for this at all. I had no expectations of this whatsoever. It came as a complete surprise out of the blue, total surprise. I said, wow, this is cool. Oh yeah, I can look at it like this. Oh, I like this. Wow. Okay, that's very helpful. Let's look at it this way. But I never made that an aim at all. So it shows you how these practices automatically empower, right, the proper shifts of frame of reference shifts. They've been given out to us by the grace of God through its you know, communication representatives like Manjushri, Jesus, Longchenpa, etc., Manjushri's apex array. And of course, Tibetan Buddhists are very much, well, Manjushri transmission of mandalic consciousness is very central. And now I see, oh, that's a much, very effective way, a very helpful way of looking at it. Wow, I can see how advanced that is now. So this is a super auspicious day, July 1st, 2017, an extremely auspicious day. I got my smoothie to start out the day. Which is a honey lemonade, frozen strawberry, Greek yogurt, 0% fat Greek yogurt, fresh blueberries, dates, pitted dates, chocolate protein powder, and amino acid L-glutamine. I think that covers it. Yeah. Pretty tasty. Very tasty. That's my breakfast. So I've been working out just in so much, and I feel pretty good. That's very surprising. I think it's because I'm doing these protein recovery drinks before I work out, during the workout, and after the workout. And I believe this is working better than before. So this is sort of a way that I would recommend, is to have like a smoothie, a recovery smoothie. And usually, if I'm going to work out, I'm going to put a banana in that too. So if I work out today, I'll put a banana in it, refresh it with a banana. It gives you the potassium for when you're working out. And drink it before you work out, and then work out for a little while, and then take a break and drink some of it. Maybe a 10, 15 minute break or so, or 20 minutes, whatever you want it. And then go back, work out again, drink some more of it. Refresh yourself, and then a break, and then go back again, work out some more, and then you know, finish it off and drink a lot afterwards, like that. So far I'm finding out that this works well for me. I'm not really achy or sore, or, which is surprising given the amount of workout that I've been doing. So we're just going to calm down here from the intro the intro of this video. The intros and the intros, the end is in the intro. So calm down and get a little grounded, because it's been quite an exuberant morning, July 1st. And I didn't know, you know, we have nowhere to go, nothing to do. And I'm just like, oh, wow. But Jesus gave me this advice yesterday on Dialogue on Awakening. He said, if you pray for something that doesn't happen, he said, that's also grace. Because it means that what would not be helpful for you is not happening. If it doesn't happen, it's of the ego. It's not helpful for you. So he's saying, grace is working because it's not happening. And I heard that. I said, you know what? Thank you, Jesus. Great advice. Great advice. So the fact that we don't have anything to do this you know, 4-day weekend. I'll probably have to work Monday. It looks like I'm working Monday. So it's just really a washout, you know, just wow, everybody's out of town, everybody's doing something, it's the big, you know, big thing. Nothing. But Jesus said that's the grace of God for you, because guess what? You just shifted into a mandalic consciousness. How fortunate. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are the suffering, the meek, the lowly. Yeah. You know why? Because I had the opportunity to go through this morning. I'm sitting in bed, I don't have anything to do. And even if you're sick, you can say this, the grace of God is shining upon me. No, the grace of God is already, super important, you have to put that already in there, okay? Have to, that's the key, one of the keys to this. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised. And it's vastly better than expected. Wow. Super potent. And keep it in this form, okay? Keep it in this form. Don't be doing a bunch of experimentation at this point. It's very important. The already-ness is extremely important. Knocks out time completely. Takes away limitation from God. Both, you're not waiting, praying for something to happen in the future, and you're also stating it's already shining upon me, means that in the past it was there too. I just noticed it. It's already shining upon me. So the grace of God is already shining upon me. So no limitation upon God. It's already there. As promised. As promised. So you're saying that, yeah, I did have faith. I did expect this would happen. But then the second part is, and is vastly better than expected. So we're practicing shocking our expectations. They're having our expectations really, really shocked. Okay, wow. Because mandalic consciousness is quite a shock to our expectations. It's really a reference frame shift for us. Very much so. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow! So it exceeds our expectations. We're reshaping our expectations for this, to experience this grace of God. And we're shocking, we're realizing it's vastly better. And our definition of it is wow. Our definition of it is just wow. That's all we can say about it. Vastly better than expected. Wow. So I've been practicing this morning, and you practice it with your you imagine, you accept that this is indeed true. This is indeed true, and my expectations are just really shocked, very shocked. It's kind of fatiguing to do this practice. Absolutely, it is. So it helps to be in good shape, helps to feel that you're strong. It helps to be working out and feel you're strong, because this will make you feel tired and weak for a while. But you say, no, I know I can bounce back, because you know I feel confident that I'm strong. Whereas if you're really weak already to start, this might demoralize you. You may not be able to do it as intensely. You could still practice it, but you may have to go a little slower. So, and especially to break the ice on this practice, it requires tremendous nerve on my part. So that's why the Holy Spirit suggested, if you want to really do your part here, you're going to need to get in this regime of losing weight, getting in shape, and being really feeling very tip-top and confident, because the strain of breaking through the collective expectations of the world at this point is such. It's like breaking through, be an icebreaker. You got to break the ice. It's quite a strain. You have to have a strong hull to break the ice, right? Oh, hummingbird. Hello. That's like mandalic consciousness hovering above. Imagine you're a hummingbird, okay? And you're hovering above this vast wheel, this flat wheel, this disc, this vast flat disc. And it's like in a mandala. It just has all these little sections to it, areas to it. As you go around and see this disc, you see it all at once. You're above, hovering above it. And you see this world is just a little area on this disc. You know, and there's that's subdivided into many, many little tiny areas. And you realize that you, your attention has just been circling around this disc, trying to produce evidence to hallucination that it's causative of this, trying to convince yourself that hallucination is not an effect but actually a cause. And so imagine you're a hummingbird just hovering up above in the center of this vast mandalic disc, mandalic disc array. And you're looking down on all of it. You see all of it at once. Wow. And you realize you're not really in that at all. You've just been projecting your attention, holding your attention in certain areas, and then moving it gradually around this disc, just moving your attention around this disc, believing that you are born and living in these conditions. But you're really not born at all. Your attention, you make your attention such that it seems as though you're born and you die and you go into this next realm, etc. But really, you're the hummingbird above this all, and you're just playing with your attention. It's a play of attention that makes it seem like you're actually in this, you know, life, death, this flat mandalic array of the transmigration of life and death, but you're really above it. You're not in it at all. It's just it's a trick you're playing on yourself, a play of attention. And then when you see it all as one, you don't see yourself as anywhere in particular in this place at all. So that's the end of your transmigration. That's the end of you thinking you're a body, thinking you're a specific person. You're this consciousness that's above it. that is not, is everywhere, is 360 degree everywhere. So we've been tricking ourselves with the play of attention. And we've talked about previously why we would do that, trying to fixate the mind, right? Because we tried to change reality, hallucinated the absence of reality, and then thought that this hallucination was actually necessary because reality actually had died and we had to create a new reality instantly. And so that this hallucination is somehow, we managed to carry some of the old reality, the dead reality, over. And now we have this creation of death. And that's our new reality. Instead of us actually just wanting to change reality and hallucinating the absence of it, when in fact reality hadn't died at all. Smoothies are like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get. I just throw stuff together and say, okay. Everyone's different. Each one's different. I rarely repeat. You know, it's just whatever you got. It's a potpourri. It's a jambalaya. And you just put in, you know, what kind of frozen stuff do I have here? What kind of this? Let me try this and this. And the mixer, this time it was the... that honey and lemonade sort of thing that just gives it a different flavor than I expected. It's a little off. But you got to keep your smoothies interesting, right? If it's the same old thing, it gets boring. So I always throw something together that surprises me. For I wonder how this is going to taste. The grace of God is already shining upon me, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow! The grace of God is already shining upon me, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow! The grace of God is already shining upon me, as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow! The grace of God is already shining upon me, as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow! The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow. So this produces the burn, the shock. Produces a state of shock, actually. Positive shock. I could feel it most definitely. That is a very powerful, powerful affirmation. Assertion. An assertion. So we are off and running big time as we speak. But right now I'm in a little bit of shock, for sure. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it is vastly better than expected. Wow! Manjushri's apex array. The gentle glory of Manjushri's apex array. Mandalic consciousness. Do not ever try to develop mandalic consciousness directly. Okay. Those are the mistakes that are made by those who want some sort of empowerment of themselves in this world. This again, I had no such intention ever. I've never focused on that. I've never been into that. I never expected that. I've never aimed at anything like that. It just spontaneously arose based on the practice of the new way practice of devaluing the I. I can never learn anything. I can never do anything. I'm completely useless. I have absolutely no value. And the practice of non-important, no importance. I've never had any importance. So I don't have any importance to get sick. I don't have the importance to die. I'm not important enough to die. I don't have any importance. I can't die. To die, you have to be very important. But I don't have any importance at all. So I can't die. I can't get sick. I can't suffer. I don't have the importance to suffer. I don't have the importance to learn. I don't have the importance to transmigrate at all. You got to be vastly important to transmigrate, but I don't have any importance at all. So devaluing the I don't have any value whatsoever, and asserting no importance, therefore, I have no importance. I was created with zero importance, therefore, I don't have the importance to die. I don't have the importance to suffer. I don't have the importance to age. I don't have the importance to rot. I don't have the importance to transmigrate. I don't have the importance to be born. Okay? I don't have the importance to do anything. I don't even have the importance to exist. Okay? I don't have the importance to be temporary. I don't have the importance to be separate. I don't have the importance to be fixated. I don't have the importance to be deluded. I don't have the importance to be deluded. I don't have the importance to be confused. I don't have the importance to be confused. I don't have the importance to suffer lack. I don't have the importance to have needs. See, all that stuff requires vast importance. I don't have any importance. I have zero importance. So those two sides of the coin of the new way practice have certainly resulted in this frame of reference shift that I experienced out of the blue. Was never expecting anything like that. I was like, huh? What's that? Where did that come from? I said, but Longchenpa came from the grace of Longchenpa, didn't it? Manjushri Apex Array, the grace of the Manjushri Apex Array, as represented by Longchenpa, Guru Longchenpa, the omniscient Dharma King Longchenpa, who I've been praying to recently and reading, so I'm getting back to that. Like the Sufis. The Sufis send those who are on the path to different masters. You know, they stay here for a while, then they move over here, then they move to this one, depending on what they're ready for, what they want to emphasize. These different masters are good at emphasizing different empowerments, helps. And so we have these different Dharma kings, and I kind of go from one to another, to another, to another. I got the new way practice from Jesus. This then helped empower the shift, frame of reference shift into mandalic consciousness, which I get from now Longchenpa, you see, the Manjushri Apex Array. We have Ananda, Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma in expert support of all of this. She's the, you know, the spiritual mother looking out after every aspect of it all, you might say. The spiritual sister, our little spiritual sister who's not distracted by any in any which way, and she's completely alert to everything, right? Completely alert. Even beyond the mother. Yep. The mother's thinking about her extension, aspects of what she can create, extend, or whatever. But the little sister is not even thinking about that at all. Not about thinking about any offspring or anything. She's just alert about everything. Equally alert in all directions. A little child just not favoring anything. Mothers favor their own offspring. So a little sister's not favoring anything. She's just completely alert to everything. Nothing gets past her. So we have that help. And at times we have the great help of Brahmaharshi, the presence, practicing the presence. Manjushri apex array, Manjushri Pamasamba, Longchapa, Jemmy Kenzi, Chogi Lodra, and then we have Jesus, Sri Sri Nanda Maima, Ramaharshi. So they all help out. They all help out. They're all synergistic. Synergistic. They're all synergistic. The grace of God is already shining upon me, as promised, and is vastly better than expected. Wow! The grace of God is already shining upon me, as promised, and is vastly better than expected. Wow! The grace of God is already shining upon me, as promised, and is vastly better than expected. Wow! So, I recommend that whenever you do this practice, do it at least 3 times. The first time, you kind of get the rust off and say, okay, this is the form. The second time, you start adding some emphasis. And the third time, you really let it go and make it very intense. And you can do it many times you want, but at least 3 times. And so I just did it 3 times, and the third time, I was able to put tremendous emphasis into it. And you can do it any time, during day or night. See, blessed are the poor in spirit. You see, we're focused on what is absolutely free, which is doing this practice. So I've always been forced into having to focus on what doesn't cost anything. Not having the money, you know, disposable income. And you know, it takes, sometimes it's a long time between getting anything. And even then I have to have help to get it. So I have to focus on what's free. I mean, what can I do that's absolutely free? Oh, I can do this. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Totally free, right? This is what Jesus was getting at in all this talk about how fortunate the poor, the suffering, the afflicted, the poor in spirit, the lowly, the meek, the humble, the ones that didn't have the means. You might be lying in bed with an affliction. Well, guess what? You can't do anything. You can't be out there playing, doing all this stuff, right? Working, playing, all this stuff. That's what happened to me in my life. I couldn't do anything except sit in a chair. But I could practice. I could study. I could affirm, which was free. So, those are the blessed ones. So they turn within and start to use what is absolutely free, which are these assertions. Prayer has too much of a begging quality to it. Say, God, please give me this, please. See, we try not to do that. We because that puts a limitation on God as if he hasn't already done it. So we say, the grace of God is already shining upon me as promised. And it's vastly better than expected. Wow. Not just a little bit. This one we're saying vastly better than expected. In other words, our expectations are being exceeded to a vast extent, and we can only express this just through wow. Like wow, this is just, you know, wow. That's all. The grace of God is already shining upon me as expected, and it's vastly. I mean, the grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and is vastly better than expected. Wow. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and is vastly better than expected. Wow. 3 times there. And that gives a kick to it. Gives a kick. You want to feel that kick, inner kick to it. So, whatever your circumstances, the lowly the better. I mean, if you really just think like, oh, I'm like, can't do anything. I'm just stuck here. You know, I'm depressed. I just know, I just feel like my life is just not really exciting, and I'm doing all these things. I don't have the money to have fun. And well, guess what? You can do this practice, which makes you more blessed than anyone who's not doing the practice, actually. I wouldn't trade places with anyone who's not doing this practice, right? No way. No way would I trade places. King of the world, queen of the world, whatever. You know, the vast ruler of the world. Yet, they're not doing this practice. Would I trade places with them? Not a chance. Not a chance. If they threw all the power and the privilege and the perks, everything, says all yours, would I trade places with them but not do this practice? No way. No way. Not a speck of chance of that. That's how valuable I view this practice. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. This is really helps us stabilize in mandalic consciousness. It's moving us into that mandalic consciousness so that we feel at home there. Okay, and from that, we're able to realize we were never actually a person entity at all in this disc, mandalic disc of transmigration. Wow. Never born. It was just a trick of attention. It was just a play of attention that I was deceiving myself, right? Liberation from the wheel of rebirth, right? Death and rebirth, absolutely. Absolutely. So, but we don't worry about results. We're not fixated on results. So we're really just focused on practicing. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow! So fortunate are you that are hearing this transmission and paying attention to it. Everyone's hearing it, but fortunate are you if you're paying attention to it and actually practicing it as best you can, as best you can. And I understand that it may not be so easy to practice this for some, but the new way of devaluing the I and asserting no importance for yourself, no importance whatsoever for your no self-importance whatsoever. That practice, the new way practice, will certainly prepare you for this, as it has me. So I'm just in the wow of this practice, the shock of this practice. It's extremely powerful, wonderfully powerful, wonderfully effective. Again, don't go on a search for results. Do not go on a search for results. That's the faith that works. Just like in the new way practice, devaluing the I have no value, and asserting no self-importance at all. I have zero importance. I'm not important enough to be born. I didn't search for any results. I just did it. I just did it. I didn't try to form any expectation of results at all. It's very important. Have no expectations of results, and then you won't interfere with the result that will automatically arise from the practice. You won't be interfering with it. And so this what part of the result has arisen is this practice, this new practice. Wow. Fabulous. But don't chase after results. Just practice with faith. Don't worry about the results. The results will arrive on their own accord when you from your dedicated practicing. I just like working out. I mean, I try not to focus on how far am I going to hit the golf ball. You know, thinking about, okay. And I say, no, I'm just working out. I'm getting stronger. I'm getting faster and faster. So the results will take care of themselves when and if appropriate time. You know, they'll be there. So I try not to think about that too much. Like how far am I going to hit it, or how am I going to? I say, no. Who knows? I'm not focused on. I'm just focused on working out. Just enjoying that process of working out, getting stronger and faster. And I enjoy that so much, I don't even worry about playing golf, actually. I don't even worry about going hitting it. I said, well, you know, whatever I hit it today, a month from now, I'll actually be hitting it farther. Whatever it is, because I'll be stronger and more flexible and, you know, better shape. So let the results take care of themselves. And really form no idea about what the results will be, really. You know, try not to focus. Focus on just practice. And that practice is powerful enough. You can feel it, so you know that this is getting powerful results in some way, but you don't need to know in which way. Don't try to form expectations. Our whole thing is to go beyond our expectations anyway. So whatever expectations we form, we're going to have to go beyond those anyway. So it's better not to try and formulate, you know, too many expectations, right? Just keep practicing. Boy, I really expected my back, everything to just be killing me, all the work, but it feels good. It is really very surprising. My knee's not too bad. You know, it hurts a bit because I've been really putting it through so much workout, but you know, it's not terrible. Better than expected, right? But in our case, the grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow! The grace of God is already shining upon me as expected, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow! The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it is vastly better than expected. Wow. Wow, wow, wow. So again, there's nobody in the world that I would want to trade places with right now who is not doing this practice. Now, I wouldn't mind trading places with Longchenpa or Jesus or something, right? But there's nobody in this world who is not at least doing this practice, or beyond this practice, so to speak, that I would want to trade places with at all. No value whatsoever, and zero importance, so I'm not important enough to trade places with anyone. I'm not important enough to trade places with anyone. I don't have the importance to trade places with anyone. I don't have the importance to trade places with anyone. Gorgeous morning here in California, Bay Area. Typical summer Bay Area, which is super nice. The cooling from the Pacific Ocean is present. So you just have these soft, cool breezes mixed with the warmth of the summer July sun. I don't know, get to maybe upper 70s today or something. All these little gentle convection currents, little cool convection currents playing around, and lovely, lovely. Not a cloud in the sky. I have no importance at all. I have no value at all. I have no importance at all. I don't have the importance to trade places with anyone. I don't even have the importance to be anyone. Okay? I don't have the importance to be anyone. And I certainly don't have the importance to trade places with anyone. I'm incapable of it. I have no value. I'm absolutely incapable of being anyone at all. I'm absolutely incapable of trading places with anyone. I don't have the importance to trade places with anyone. So how's it going so far? First half an hour, huh? Very intense, I have to say. Smoothie break. Getting to the dates now. I didn't blend it long enough. So there's a lot of little pieces of dates down at the bottom, which are great. So I could feel this hitting my nerves really strongly. It's like a very intense workout. But as we have acclimatized ourselves to more and more intense workouts, we say, well, yeah, I can handle this. I do many repetitions with smaller weights. There's a school of thought that says that's better than few repetitions with really heavy weights. That's for building real bulky mass, I think. A few repetitions with really heavy weights. But doing for flexibility and overall athleticism, they say it's better to do many repetitions with lesser weights. And so that's what I do. Just dumbbells. I used to use dumbbells. That's it. I just have a kettlebell, which is 15 pounds. I have a 30 pound dumbbells. And a couple of maybe, I don't know what they are, 7 pound, 6 pound dumbbells, real light ones for like doing 50 of difficult kind of stuff that you can't have, the weight can't be too heavy. That's it. The only one I bought was the kettlebell. The others I'm borrowing. I borrowed the 30 pounders for someone who had them, wasn't using them. And the light, like maybe there's, I don't know, 7 pound dumbbells, I got from my uncle. They're the ones my uncle used. It's a keepsake, heritage treasure from my wonderful uncle, who worked out every morning, every day, was in fabulous shape. And He went out on a brisk morning walk in the desert, and a thunderstorm, unexpected thunderstorm, suddenly rolled in, and super cold, drenched him, and he got hypothermia, severe hypothermia, and he couldn't talk. And everybody thought that he had a psychotic breakdown, and they thought he had Alzheimer's, and they misdiagnosed him, and then put him on heavy medication for it, and put him in a restricted living, a really imprisoned place where you couldn't escape, lockdown facility for Alzheimer's. He didn't have Alzheimer's, any of that stuff at all. Yeah, he got severe hypothermia, and nobody investigated what had happened at all. It was unbelievable. And I went down and tried to rescue him. It took months and months of effort. It was, but the trauma of going through that shocked him severely. Amazing. But he had only himself to, he's responsible for that. In terms of what it was he told me repeatedly that the way the world was going is a disaster, he says. And he didn't want to, he said, I don't want to be part of it. I don't want to be around. It's going to really be hell here. And so that sudden thunderstorm that caught him, drenching cold, symbolized what his expression of the world, of how it was going to be. And that was his way of leaving the world, because he was so healthy. I think he feared that he might keep living through the times that he didn't want to live through. So he engineered this situation so he would get traumatized and then get misdiagnosed, and then one thing after the other, and it gradually wore his health down. And then he ultimately he choked on his breakfast and got some down his lungs or something, inhaled some of the pureed breakfast or something. They pureed it for him. He wasn't used to that. And it choked on him, and it cut off his oxygen, and he died. But that was all because he wanted to. Same with my dad. He said, I've had enough of this world. He told me, I said, that I can't be here the way I want to be here. I can't anymore. And so I'm not interested anymore. He said he was ready for other adventures. He was very adventurous. So he said, I want to keep trucking the way, and this world, I can't really do it anymore. Too many restrictions, too much, people are too uptight, the whole vibe has shifted and everything. So he was ready to go to, along the wheel of transmigration. But I don't suggest either of those strategies now. I suggest practicing. Okay, this is auspicious what we're doing. We can shift into mandala consciousness even while people think that we're here. They're just a body that they think is us, but it's not us at all. Nobody is us. I'm nobody. I don't have any value at all. I have nobody whatsoever. I have no importance whatsoever. I'm not important enough to be any one of these specks of life forms, so-called death forms, really, in this vast wheel of transmigration. I don't have any value at all. I'm not important enough to be on the wheel of transmigration at all. Okay, so you don't have to die at all. You don't have to die. But I see people orchestrate their own deaths for sure. My uncle's was a very clever one. And I tried to prevent it, but he was determined. He said, finally told me, just be quiet. Just be quiet. I was talking, trying to, said, quiet, quiet. And his eyes, he was already in seeing the next, whatever it was. He was very, you could see, it was amazing. He had otherworldly consciousness going on, most definitely. He was very quiet as I was driving him in a car, and he was just, his eyes were like shining with it, some different kind of light. It's amazing. So he had enough. He was ready to drop his body form. He was ready, but to transmigrate, to find some other, and the wheel is vast. This disc, mandalic disc of transmigration, is this vast wheel of so many different varieties of death, of impermanence, conditioned existence. That we, it's like a candy store. You know, we're like kids in the candy store. We say, oh, this candy's so wonderful, so bright. Oh, look at that candy over there, and right over there. Oh, get that. There's all these jars of candy everywhere. And, you know, the kids just like go bananas. Got to go check that one out over there. And they think it's so glorious and wonderful. At some point, they start saying, wait a minute, I've gone to a lot of candy jars, and I know that one looks attractive, but I know I'll get bored with it too. And I'll say, tired of this candy. And this could just go on forever, right? Like, wait a minute, what's going on here? And we don't want to overburden ourselves, so, because we're in the intensity of this practice. And just, one way you can have smoothies is you put in this dried fruit like dates and apricots and cherries, things like that. And so as you get to the bottom of the smoothie, they've settled to the bottom. If you don't puree them completely, which is difficult, but you can if you let it go long enough. And then you get this really nice, soft, kind of tasty, sweet stuff at the bottom of the smoothie. That's great. So I almost feel like running out in the streets crying Eureka, but, you know, but we don't do that. I'm crying Eureka here for sure. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow! The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow! The grace of God is already shining upon me, as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow! Now, most of the world is only looking for those who can tell them about some more interesting place along the wheel of transmigration. Like, oh, you know, I went to this place. It was really nice. You got to check that out. Or this place. And they're not thinking at all about the vertical shift into mandalic consciousness. They're not thinking about going vertical like that. So they're not really paying attention to this here. They're paying attention to somebody who says, yeah, you know, there's this island down in the South Pacific, and you got to check this out, you know, get the GPS, Google it, and it's really cool, you can go there, yeah, they got the resort there. Okay, so they're thinking about, you know, how can they move horizontally around the wheel of transmigration and find that place, you know, that they've been looking for, find that death that they've been looking for, to convince a hallucination, which is just an effect of mine, that it's really causative. So all this death is just trying to convince an effect that it's causative. The mind's just trying to convince itself that effect is causative, is what it's really doing, trying to do. Mind is trying to convince itself that effect is fundamentally, primarily causative. And of course, mind trying to be greater than God, since mind is an effect of God, so to speak. Mind is trying to say, no, God, mind is primarily causative. So I'm the real prime creator, trying to reverse the direction of creation. So all these deaths along the wheel of transmigration that we're seeking, believing that is happening to us, which is not, they're just effects we're imagining, a play of attention. They're trying to convince, it's all designed to try and convince the mind that hallucination effect is causative. And it's causing all these effects of transmigration. this primary hallucination is causing, we try to convince our mind, trying to convince itself that it's causing the primary hallucination, which is an effect, is causing all these other effects. Whereas mind is causing all of it simultaneously. And of course, we need time to believe in this delusion, right? To say, first came this primary effect, you know, and then it's extended creatively to cause all these other effects of death. So these other effects are secondary, you know, to this primary effect, and that makes this primary effect causative. No, it's all being sustained simultaneously, moment by moment, by the mind. Probably imagines simultaneously, instantly, by the mind. The mind is always instantaneous, being created that way by God. Doing the 6-to-6 diet, so it's great because before 6 you can eat. I had a nice veggie burger. If as long as I do it before 6, I said, well, that's okay. So you could eat, you know, not that has that many calories actually, but it feels like it does, right? Like a big meal, a big veggie burger with lots of cheese. And it felt like I was really pigging out, but I said, well, I did it before 6, so now I don't eat again till, 6 in the morning plus 11 o'clock, 5, 12, 12 and 5, 17. So really, I went like 17 hours without food. 6 o'clock in the afternoon, then 6 in the morning to 11. 17 hours. And this is what really helps you lose weight, is giving your body a chance to burn calories, you know, to burn. So I condense my eating into what, a 7 hour 7 hour period, really. Right now it's like noon to 6 or 11 to 6, that's a 7 hour period. So in that 7 hour period I'll eat something, but the rest of the time I won't. And so this I believe this really helps you lose weight without having to work out too much, right? It's sort of a natural, easy way to lose weight. And it's especially helpful if you don't eat any, you don't get up at 6 in the morning and start pigging down a lot. I mean, you get up like a weekend, get up late, don't eat anything, skip breakfast and just have a lunch. And then have a dinner before 6, and that's it. And then another, you know, 17 hours for Sunday, same thing. Now on work days, you have to get up and probably eat something at 7 o'clock or something. But a weekend, you can really just skip breakfast. And that really helps lose weight. So hopefully I'm starting to lose a little weight. I have to do all this stuff. It's difficult. I don't have a lot of rajastic energy to get up and go. Very sattvic in terms of that. And I'd rather just sit here quietly. But of course the intensity is more intense than anything you could be doing, really, this intensity here. The other kind of intensity is very superficial, isn't it? Intensity of the flesh, very superficial. This intensity here is very spiritual intensity. And you feel it's you know, vastly greater than expected. You know, the results will be vastly greater than expected. That kind of, you feel like, wow. So we're really exceeding expectations to such a vast extent. And that can really only be done spiritually. Whereas the world, you know, we exceed expectations in a very superficial way by what we do physically in the world. You hear a new song and say, oh, wow, that exceeded my expectations. But really, it's very, very trivial kind of stuff. It just keeps us moving around that disc, flat disc of transmigration through all sorts of different realms, structure, all sorts of imagined structure realms. I have this structure, now I have this structure, now I have this light body structure, now I have this denser body structure, now I have this physical body structure, now I have this etheric structure, now I have this, you know, different realms, different places, fast wheel of transmigration, of death. Now there can be a mandala, a vast wheel, mandalic array of the non-death realms, no death, which is saying that effect is just effect. And it's not trying to fixate hallucination. It's basically saying effects are, will always be effects. So nothing is being transformed by death. Right? No illusion of an absence of reality. Just the realms of the non-death realms, the non-death mandala. And ultimately, we can go beyond that. But I'm just saying, it's quite possible we can experience the mandala, the non-death mandala, while here in this world. All simultaneously, this entire non-death mandala, death-free mandala, 360 degrees, this vast disc, all shining upon us simultaneously as we're this hummingbird up above it, and it's like reflecting the light of God. It's all shining, the entire disc, 360 degrees, every facet is shining up upon us, and we're the hummingbird above it, and we're experiencing that. Wow. Grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow! The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow! The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised, and it's vastly better than expected. Wow! So, wow, stick with the practice. We won't go chasing after results. Don't go seeking or chasing. We can just sort of gradually mention, as you know, gradually we tune in, but don't chase, don't seek after it. Just practice. And at some point, you know, some frame of reference shift will take place. Absolutely. So people said to me, oh, you got to play golf this weekend. I had a good time to play. Well, God had other plans at this point, right? Maybe I'll play anyway later, but God said, you know what? It's a great weekend to shift your consciousness into mandalic consciousness. We'll start there. Okay, just start with mandalic consciousness. And I realize that there's a higher mandala conscious of the realm, the death-free realms. Okay, I say, okay, there's a mandala of that, but I'm not chasing after it. I know it's there, but I said, if it comes, it comes. But you know, if I chase after it, I won't get it. So I'm just going to stick with this, practice this, get used to it. I'm happy with what we have right now. Extremely profound. The king cobra signifies mandalic consciousness. I just realized that. The loop of its tail signifies transmigration, the disc of transmigration, the mandala of transmigration. And then the cobra, its body goes up and the head is up above, as if it can look down on the mandala of transmigration. And then the king cobra has a crown on top of it, signifying the crown of enlightenment, at least the crown of mandalic consciousness, you might say. And I was told to get these hats. I finally did. I said, I just got to get them. The Holy Spirit said, you got to get that. That's part of your outfit. Come on. And I said, well, I tried before. I didn't get it. I said, go get it. You know. I said, okay, boom. I ordered two of them. One in white and black and one in blue and white. The cobra has often been used as a symbol of this mandalic consciousness, I realize now. You know, Krishna, I think, has showed this thousand-headed cobra, you know, rising up like that. And it's Egyptians used it as a royal symbol of mandalic consciousness, higher consciousness, enlightened consciousness. In Hinduism, it's very much used as a symbol of enlightened consciousness, especially the king cobra. It's a very unique animal, the way it raises up like that, right? It raises up and its hood spreads out like that. And it's able to look down on itself like that from on high. It's amazing. The hummingbird also is a great symbol. But the cobra may be even better because it's all one body, all one consciousness. It's able to look down and see, oh, this is just a projection. All of this, my body, I'm the one who is imagining this mandalic disc of transmigration. And it's my attention that God was playing as if I was some individual transmigrating along through here, through all of this. Okay, so I'm the one who's doing all of that. So just like in our workouts, the physical workouts, we drink some, you know, recovery drink while we're working out in between breaks. We do that. I was doing the recovery drink here. Spiritual recovery drink. Because this is, way more intense than any real workout. It's different intensity. You can't get this intensity any other way. This is genuinely profound intensity. With genuine ramifications. We're talking about frame of reference shift here. And definitely we have to be, certainly we have to be it's intense. I can feel it. I'm on the edge, it seems like. You can break into too much enthusiasm here if I'm not careful. How to keep it calm. Maybe you do a fidget spinner break, you know, just... And you just watch this wheel. Until it stops. Just say, wow. Little bird, little brown sparrow. A brown sparrow came to me yesterday, a day before yesterday, too, hopping into a garage, going inside, and I just stood there, waited for it to come out. Another little brown sparrow came through here. So maybe we have a great use for fidget spinners, right? Give us a little break. Let's everyone do a fidget spinner break. You have your own fidget spinner in your meditation. You say, well, I need to do nothing for just a while here. I'm feeling a little too jazzed up. And you just, you know. And you just say, I'm not going to do anything until this fidget spinner stops spinning. I'm not going to do anything at all. I just have to stay still here, right? I wonder if it's horizontal, if it spins longer. Maybe. Maybe. And you just watch the fidget spinner. So you're not really thinking about anything. You're just waiting for it to stop. That's all. Don't take your attention off of it. Just wait for it to stop. Wait for it to stop. There you go. And you feel that really helps calm you down. It sort of takes the edge off of your, as you start feeling that it's getting too intense, you can try that. Full stop in the wow. Keep in mind that this practicing does bring about tremendous shock, tremendous wow. So we do have to be committed to doing absolutely nothing for a while after we practice this. We have to be really committed to do nothing, which is why it's very important that you don't have importance in this world. and people ascribe importance to your time and action. Nobody thinks I'm important at all. So nobody cares in the world at all that I'm just sitting here doing nothing. So that's an extreme advantage, actually. Otherwise, people say, you're really important. I feel you're a really important person. You're a really helpful person. You should be out doing something. Come on, do some charity event. Do this, do this, do this, do this, do this. So there's nobody nagging me to do anything. So I have this, somehow I'm nobody, you know. So that's super helpful. Whereas if they think you have a talent, they say, well, use your talent to help the world, you know. To help convince effect that it's causative. Come on, use your talent here. Help everybody stay on this wheel of transmigration, the death wheel of transmigration, so we can convince hallucination that it's causative of all this. That's what they're really saying. Instead, nobody expects anything of me. I have acquaintances that I meet through work. We just talk because we see each other often. I don't have any social friends at all. So nobody ever calls me. I never get phone calls from social acquaintances other than family. Rarely. Super rare. So nobody calls me. Nobody expects anything of my time. So I can do nothing like this. Appear to do nothing. But what we're doing is actually the most important doing there is here. So the most important doing there is done in sitting quietly like this, practicing, and then full stop in the wowing. That's by far and away, nothing even can compare with it in any way, because that's what lifts us vertically into mandalic consciousness, as opposed to keeping this flat wheel, death wheel of transmigration consciousness. The false attention, you know, play of attention that's designed to give a false impression. Trying to convince effect that it's causative. Ah, nice little buzz of a cicada there. Lovely. Love that. That's a nice summertime sound. But I gotta say, this practice is really knocking me out. There's no doubt about it. There's a cicada again. Love hearing that sound. Summer sound. Sounds of summer. Full of promise, isn't it? Summertime. It's like the fullness of spring has bloomed. Everything's lush, green, blooming for the summer. The gardens are all growing, producing fruit and everything. Right. Wow, what a wonderful time. And then comes the dreadful fade of autumn. And then the horrible starkness of winter. And then... the hopefulness of spring as greenness seems to return. And then we head towards, again, the lush fulfillment of summer. But it's always summer on the inside. Which that was actually coined by Jack O'Neill from O'Neill Surf Company, I believe. It's always, that was one of their marketing models. It's always, for their wetsuits, it's always summer on the inside. That's a great spiritual mantra, isn't it? It's always summer on the inside. Mandalic consciousness is always summer in mandalic consciousness. It's always the fulfillment stage. There's never the fade away. There's never the fade. There's never the hope and there's never the fear. It's always just the lush fulfillment stage. Just that. So I can feel the wow very powerfully deep down. So I'm not going to practice that anymore right now. This is enough for this session in terms of that practice goes, more or less. You know me, I might push it a little more if I feel better. So don't overdo this practice. It's really, 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 really strong. Don't be the fool like the rabbit that tries to go too fast and ends up retreating, losing all the gains that it had. Be the tortoise, two steps forward, one step back. So we step back from the practice when we feel the intensity is getting really intense, and this is the first time I've done this practice, so I'm just testing it out. And the intensity is off the charts, really, is the most intense practice I've ever experienced. Even more intense than the new way practice of devaluing the I and devaluing self-importance. It's even more intense than that. Moving on up to a deluxe apartment in the sky. All praise to the Manjushri Apex Array, Apex Mandalic Array. All praise to the Manjushri Apex Mandalic Array. Wow. The Guru certainly had Mandalic Consciousness, Manjushri at least, that array, and even beyond that, you might say, but they most certainly did have that. Wow. The mind that's too busy and smart will say, well, I don't have time to sit there quietly. I'm so important that people need me to do stuff. So it will just grab a hold of the form and won't actually practice it to allow the shock to settle in. Or it will not do nothing for a while and allow the shock to calm down. And when they do that, the backlash comes, hits them. They end up losing the gains they had. And saying, what's wrong? Well, self-importance is what is wrong. So go back and practice the new way practice. You have trouble with this practice, you go back, do the new way practice of I have absolutely no value whatsoever. I'll never have any value whatsoever. And I'm not important enough. I don't have importance to have value. I don't have any importance at all. I don't have the importance to be valuable at all. I don't have the importance to suffer. Don't have the importance to be born. I don't have the importance to die. Go through all that importance practice. The I have no value. I'm not capable of anything at all. I can't do anything. I can't succeed in any way. I can never be happy. I can never succeed in any way. I'm not able to do anything, actually. I'm unable to do anything. I'm incapable of doing anything whatsoever. It's called devaluing the I practice. I'll never succeed. I will never succeed. I will never know anything. I can't change anything whatsoever. I'm incapable of change, totally incapable of change. I can't make anything better. I'm of no use to anyone, absolutely no use to anyone. I can never help anyone in any way. Is devaluing the I practice. And the other is the importance. I was created with zero importance, so I don't have the importance to suffer. I don't have the importance to transmigrate at all. I don't have the importance to be born. It takes a lot of importance to be born, doesn't it? You must be really important. I don't have any importance. I can't do that. Not possible. I don't have the currency to buy that experience, do I? I have no importance. I'm not important enough to be deluded. Don't have the importance to be confused. Don't have the importance to be deluded. Don't have the importance of this. So it's just the other side of the coin, where we could say I'm incapable of being deluded. I'm incapable of being deluded. I can't even do that. I can't even delude myself. I have no capabilities at all. I have no capacities whatsoever. I don't even have the capacity to die. I don't even have the capacity to be born. I have no capacity, no capability, no value. No capacity, capability, value. I'm not able to even suffer. Not able to suffer at all. Not able to be happy. Not able to succeed. Not able to fix anything. I can't fix anything. I have no value. I can't fix anything. I have no value. I can't do anything. I have no value. I can't change anything. I have no value. I can't be anything. Anything. I have no value. I can't make effect causative. I have no value. I'm incapable of changing anything at all. I'm incapable of changing. I can't even change myself. I can't even change myself. I have no value. I can't even change myself. Now these practices are super intense also when I first started doing them, but after a month, they're not quite as intense. But they still are intense when I do them, absolutely. So this is the New Way practice is this tremendous, tremendous transitional practice. No doubt about it. It's the New Way. So this is the key, the cornerstone of the New Way is this, I have no value and I have no importance. Two ways of saying the same thing, but slightly different spin. Like, you know what? I'd love to die, but I don't have the importance to die. I just don't have the importance. I got to be really important to die, and I just don't have that importance. So it puts sort of a more lighthearted spin on it. You can kind of have fun with it. Yeah, I'd love to be a body, but that takes massive importance, and I was created with no importance whatsoever. So I can't be born. I can't have a body. Can't never have a body. Yeah, I'd love to be transmigrating along the wheel of transmigration, but I don't have the importance to do it. It takes an unbelievable amount of importance, and I was created with zero importance. So not a chance for me. Not even a chance. Can't do it. Not important enough. Don't have the importance to do that. So for those who are really sincere, this path will certainly work tremendously. And for those who are not really sincere, they just want to find some advantage in the wheel of transmigration, then of course it will not work out for them the way that they want. They'll think, okay, anyway, it's ultimately fizzle out, so to speak. Don't search for results. If you're really sincere, then you'll know you have the practice that works. And so you'll just do it. That's all. If I get a golf tip and I know this will work for me. I know it. Then I just practice it. I don't like practice it twice and say, oh, okay, let me go out and get the result from it. No, I said, Not really interested in that yet. I'm interested in practicing it so it's really grooved. Like Tom Watson, the great golfer, I walked with him when he was playing, right with him on the fairway, right with him when he was playing, and his muscle memory was so grooved. I've never seen anything like it. He didn't have to think about it. He didn't have to think. He just determined, okay, what kind of shot do I want to hit? And his muscles memory just knew how to hit it. I was really quite astonished by that. He was a freak, a genius, golf genius, Tom Watson. One of the greatest of all time, for sure. No doubt about it. And had this just effortless muscle memory of just, so he had really practiced. You knew here's someone that had, you know, really, really, really practiced. He's also a genius at it, but he grooved his muscle memory. These pros, they groove their muscle memory, so they're not out just playing golf necessarily all the time. They're on the driving range. They're practicing. They're at the weight room. They're practicing, grooving that muscle memory so that it's just there. They know exactly what to do. Well, so, and then when it comes time to have a tournament, you know, they just use that muscle memory and let the results speak for themselves. That's all. They just stay within that. So those are the real pros who really put in the practice intelligently. And then again, they just, whatever results come, it is what it is. It is what it is. But we're really fixed on keep staying in the groove of our practice, staying in that groove. And if you happen to win a tournament, well, great. But they still stay in the groove. They don't let it go to their head, you know. Otherwise, they'll regress. So here, we're not interested in winning some prize necessarily. We're interested in doing what we know works, will work for us ultimately. When it will work, we're not worried about. We know this is a fast path we're on, and so it'll once our expectations are ready to receive it, then whatever results will rise, for sure, automatically they will rise when our expectations are ready to receive them, these results, because it's already there. The grace of God is already there. It's just a matter of our attention. It is pivoting our attention off this delusionary play of attention we've been engaged in, of making ourselves believe, you know, that we're just this individual entity, this person, this structure, in this vast wheel of transmigration, death wheel of transmigration. We shift our attention off of that to the vertical like that, and then we see, oh, wow. Just a shift of attention is what it is. I always said the Holy Spirit is just engaged in a play of attention with us. It always, for me, it was always it's always attention. You know, hey, shift your attention off of that onto this. Get used to shifting your attention, you know. Hey, you're missing this, you know. Shift your attention there. Shift your attention there. And your exercises, you could even have exercises where you do that, where you, like, you turn 180 degrees, and now you're looking kind of behind you like that, and you don't expect to ever be looking behind you, are you? You bend up like this, and you're looking up. You say, oh my gosh, I don't ever expect to be looking up at the sky while I'm standing on the ground. You know, the ability to practice shifting your sensory expectation is kind of a corollary type of thing. It probably is a little bit helpful for our expectations. Yeah. Part of it, sort of a yoga of it all. Don't make that the primary practice, but that can be an ancillary kind of accessory thing. Instead of just, you know, fixating on just, you know, like blinders, you know. Look up in that corner, you know, like twist and bend and hold it like that. Now your attention is, they say, okay, it's normal to be shifted vertically like that. Okay, I've got vertical attention now, like that. Pivoting, I pivot my attention. So pivot your attention 180 degrees like that. Pivot your attention. Yeah. You know, kids are just like naturally that they kind of, when they're walking, they're kind of skipping around. You see their attention is all over the place, right? Easily. Whereas older people, they're lumbering like this, and their attention's just like, you could just see. It's just so. Circumscribed by just, you know, this blinders, like, yeah, the kids are skipping around, dancing around, like, they're not fixated like that, right? Their attention is not, doesn't, pretending to be fixated, it's just, we're being held, it's not fixated, it's not crystallized, attention never crystallizes. We can hold our attention somewhere, but it never crystallizes. So trance states in attempt to crystallize the attention never work. Never crystallizes. So they have to keep holding it, holding it, holding it. And they say, when's it going to crystallize? It never crystallizes. That's why nirvana and samsara are the same in intrinsic spaciousness. No crystallization is ever happening. Our intention never crystallizes. But we can hold it someplace indefinitely if we want to. Like a border collie, you know, staring at you, waiting for you to throw them the ball. Talk about holding attention. That's the ultimate, one of the ultimate examples, right? I mean, I've never seen anything like it. Their attention doesn't waver. And it can go on and on and on and on and on and on. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes. As long as they think you're going to throw that ball, a possibility of it, they don't take their eyes off you. It doesn't move. It doesn't move. They're like a stone. Like a trance state. They go like a trance state. And we blame the body. The body's not help. Body's not allowing me to crystallize my attention. You know, body's to blame. I want to try and fixate my attention, crystallize it, so I can try to prove that effects are causative. I want to prove the hallucination that effects are positive. So I got to fixate the mind, fixate my attention, and the body's preventing me from doing that. So I'm going to blame the body. I'm going to starve the body. I'm going to treat the body bad. I'm going to do this. That's Buddha, right? The Buddha went through trance states, couldn't fixate the attention. But then blamed the body and tried to mortify the flesh so it could fixate, he could fixate attention. And finally realized, oh, attention can't be fixed. Oh, yeah. Mandalic consciousness. Buddha mind. Gautama Buddha. There are many Buddhas. We're all Buddha mind. There's just, right, really, right? Infinite expressions of Buddha mind, but all one Buddha mind. Yeah, this one is really the intensity of this breakthrough is so strong. It's not really wearing off much. So, yeah, it's a tough one. I mean, I'm going to have to battle through this one in terms of the nerves. I mean, the intensity is just still there. It's like a shockwave, really, well, vastly exceeding my expectations. Right. So, just have to be very patient. But what else is there to do? Unless July 4th, at least the United States, July 4th weekend, which of course July 4th is Independence Day. Where I guess the Declaration of Independence was signed in Philadelphia. for the colonies to declare independence from the crown, Great Britain, King George and all that. I don't think George was around at that point, but from the British Commonwealth, declared independence. And, you know, British didn't like that. They said, hey, no, we need your taxes. You are a cash cow for us. And they said, the colonial said, no, we want to keep that money for ourselves. And you can understand both sides of it, really. Great Britain, you know, supported, founded, funded, everything, you know, was the one that supplied so much to the colonies and had a thriving trade and all that. So, you know, it was a legitimate colony. And then the colony said, you know what? We want to keep the money for ourselves. They said it was about freedom of this and this and that, but it was really about money. It was really about money. Of course. It's always about money, isn't it, here? So I don't blame, you can't blame Britain for being upset about that, the British Commonwealth. We were, you know, their vast, beautiful, wonderful, prosperous colony that they established, really. And the bourgeois here said, you know what? We can be a lot wealthier if we, you know, keep the money for ourselves and stop letting the crown, you know, take a lot of it. So they said, let's declare independence here, and which is what they did, and they thought they could defeat the British, but they were able to ultimately. I think the French helped, because the French didn't want the British to have all this powerful colony, because it was enriching them, helping them out so much that they could try to dominate France, you know. So France said, yeah, independence for America, great thing. Politics, economics is so the way it is, right? Money, power, money. We gotta make effects causative. Come on, we need more power, more money. But some say that the U.S. has never actually become independent of the British Commonwealth, actually. Federal Reserve saw to that. And, you know, there's all this stuff about, really, it's still pretty, you know, pretty much a colony of England. Who knows, right? There's all sorts of, it's all this banking and money and things like that. But we got some freedoms that made up our constitution about how we wanted to be governed here. So we celebrate July 4th with fireworks. Hey, I'm not into fireworks anymore. I used to be really into it, like most kids, right? I mean, it's just, I thought it was the greatest thing in the world. Love. I always waited every year. 4th of July is the best day of the year, because we get to go out and just shoot off all these fireworks and smoke and sparkly sparks. Oh my gosh, just loved it. Actually then tried to build my own, you know, and like kids trying to charcoal and saltpeter and put them in big little pinwheels and fuses and make it go around, little bottle rockets and stuff. You know, the kids trying to have fun, like every day's the 4th of July, you know, because then they ultimately outlawed fireworks here, which is kind of a bummer, you know. You can go down to other places have them, but they have firework displays now where you got to go and sit somewhere and watch this distant fireworks display. I mean, what is that? I got no interest in that, really. Not so much. What's fun is doing it on your patio, you know, with your friends, where you're jumping out of the way of the spinners, you know. You're like, whoa, get out of the way of that one, and the rockets are going up, you know. But
to go in their neighbor's yard or something. Gotta make sure you got water so there's no fire. But it's an exciting time for kids when you have your own fireworks display. It's really, the kids just have a blast with that. Literally. So, but I just I don't have any interest in it anymore, you know. But it used to be the greatest thing. I thought it was just, you know, loved it. And kids are setting off bombs all over the place. You know, you on 4th of July, you hear just the whole neighborhood just getting rocked. So kids, of course, are still into it. I think they always will be into loud explosions and sparkly displays of sparkly. And it's beautiful. The best one was what, the year 2000, like the. What was it, over the bridge, Thames Bridge, or the London Bridge or something? I think that maybe that might have been it. There's some really, truly spectacular displays. That might have been it. We were in 1965, I think, maybe, in Switzerland, Lake Geneva. My dad was teaching over there for the summer. And that's the last time I really traveled with the family or anything. I believe that was it. 1965, one trip to Europe. They had this mass Fête de Genève over the Lake Geneva, huge parade there, and then massive fireworks. That as a kid, like a 10-year-old kid, basically. I think I might have been maybe the summer of '66, because we were home in the summer of '67 for the summer of love in San Francisco, but. So it might have been 66 or 65. World Expo was in Montreal that year, so I could check which year it was. Went to that, and then we flew over to Switzerland, stayed there. And the Fête de Genève over Lake Geneva was spectacular, because it's reflecting in these vast, this beautiful lake there. My gosh, that really sold me on fireworks to get that display. I said, oh my gosh, that's what I want to do with my life. I want to be an expert in fireworks and set off these beautiful displays, you know, for everyone. I really wanted to be that. And I ended up doing a lot of beautiful graphics, like fireworks, you know, like as if, you know, graphic fireworks, just beautiful graphics. But that's just very mundane, actually, isn't it? Very mundane. Wow, there's the cool breeze. Should be foggy at the beach, though, so it's a bummer for the people who go to the beach for the fireworks. There's a big, heavy fog layer over there right now. People like to go to the beach and the boardwalk, they shoot off fireworks there. But I don't know where any fireworks are going to be, really. I never paid any attention anymore, and I got zero interest in any of that. The fireworks are right here, aren't they? The real fireworks are right here in this video. And they're so stunning that I'm, you know, more shut down than watching the Fête de Genève. Way more stunned. This is a really stunning display of dharmic effectiveness. Wow. Mandalic consciousness effectiveness. Wow. So yeah, people get time to get the lemonade out and the burgers, and I'm actually eating burgers and lemonade now. How about that? It's very appropriate, right? Veggie burgers. Throw in all the condiments, you know, everything on there. I got to get some lettuce and tomatoes though. I think we're out of that. Pickles. I'm not eating onions anymore, so it's a little different. I used to have lots of onions, but. Onions are a non-sattvic food. I said, you know what? Let's cut out onions. Cut out garlic, too. Garlic's supposed to be really bad for you. I mean, there's a lot of studies that it's... Yogis don't eat garlic. It's prohibited. It really crosses the blood-brain barrier. And the U.S. flight surgeon, the Air Force flight surgeon, prohibits pilots from eating any garlic like 72 hours before they fly. They say it inhibits your reactions terribly. You know, it's completely prohibited. It's so dangerous. I've done a lot of studies on it, and they say that garlic is really very bad for us, actually. Of course, the garlic industry keeps trumpeting how, like, it cures everything, you know. It's the ultimate antibiotic. Well, it slows down your reaction speed in many, many different ways. And I thought garlic was so wonderful for us. I used to eat so much garlic. Maybe that really caused me a lot of problems. Don't eat garlic. You know, we're on the side of caution. I used to put it in everything. But now I've really cut it out. And it's working. Cut out the onions and the garlic. Don't take chances. You know, give yourself every advantage you can. Why not? You deserve it. Don't shortchange yourself. Have a sattvic diet. This certainly helps stay calm, which is very important. At least the ability to be patient and sit here quietly is all important, right? This is how to do nothing. Where you have a rajasic diet, it's designed to get you to do. Go, 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 go. Which virtually everyone in the world is, you know, these days are like that. California, holy cow, it's so rajasic's crazy. I went to the east side, San Jose, yesterday. I said, man, the drivers here are just even worse than Silicon Valley, actually. They got smaller cars, and they're not so expensive, and they take so many risks, and they're just zipping around, and very, very, very aggressive, super aggressive. I couldn't believe it. The aggression over there was even worse than Silicon Valley. Wow. I said, dangerous driving over here. And a lot of cars, you can see they've been smashed, fender smashed. A guy made a turn, we both turned together, and he went looped in my lane like that. He's a reckless driver. I can see his front fender there on the right was already smashed, you know. They drive with one hand, and they're just zipping around these cars like they're really, you know, real hip, cool, rajistic maniacs. They're on the move, you know, it's that kind of thing. Their diets are such, they're all hyped up on energy drinks and a super rajistic diet and lifestyle. And so the way they drive is careening all over the place, man. Look out, get out of my way. Wow. A little different than the Silicon Valley. A little different, even worse, more intense, more dangerous. They don't really care if they get in an accident so much. The techies are always trying to strategically save some time by cutting in, but they don't really want to get in accidents. And the people with expensive cars, they certainly don't want to. So slightly different style. But I really noticed it. My goodness. The east side is where the poor people live, really. I mean, comparatively poor, right? The working class and those, service class, working class, those are not upscale at all. And so they get in these new cars, fast cars, and they say, you know, at least I can feel like I'm somebody important in this car, and they drive like it. Like, get out of my way. I almost got hit. The car was coming so fast, I turned and I didn't expect it was on me like in an instant. I had to slam my brakes on and not go in the lane because I realized, oh, it's coming too fast. It's going to hit me. And what are these people thinking about driving so fast at rush hour where you know everybody's merging and turning and it's clogged up and they're going like 50 miles an hour on these surface streets? You know, that's just super reckless driving. Rush hour, you should be calm, 35. Know that people are going to be turning out, pulling in front of you and stuff. But they're trying to, like, prevent it. Like, if I just go really fast, nobody can stop me. That kind of feeling. That's rajistic energy. If I just go really fast, nobody can stop me. And, of course, if everybody feels that way, there's going to be a lot of accidents. And there are. Tow trucks everywhere. Hey, it's great to be a tow truck driver right now. I'll tell you what. If you own a tow truck company, you are raking in the dough. Because they're busy nonstop. Never seen so many tow trucks. Everywhere you see tow trucks here. And, man, rajistic. So the rajistic diet and lifestyle. Stimulants, stimulants, stimulants. Hot peppers, Tabasco sauce, you know. Spicy food, meat, meaty food, beef. Adrenaline, like caffeine, drugs, stimulants, sex, drugs, rock and roll, you know, rap music, this kind of being today, and you know, liveliness, It's in the air, like it's like, you know, spices are in the air, spicy and piquant and vivacious and zipping here and there and moving and going and doing and like that. That's rajastic energy that easily turns into some sort of crusade. Like, hey, everybody, we feel so jazzed up, we could really go to war and have a lot of fun. So that kind of energy lends itself to warfare, absolutely. And many, you know, through history, it was these people who were jazzed up, very rajistic, who went away to war saying, this is going to be the greatest adventure of my life. I can't wait. This is going to be fabulously rajistic. Man, it's going to have a lot of action here. And, of course, they got it, but then later on they said, you know what? I didn't really like it as much as I thought I would. Like World War One, all these chivalrous young men coming back from the war, it's like, you know, they were wrecks. Because they sat in foxholes or trenches for year after year, freezing to death, and they said, this ain't so fun. I want to, you know, I want to be riding a horse, tilting like knights. But very easy to control rajastic population and turn them into soldiers, warfare. Very, very easy. So, warlike nations promote rajastic energy in people, and the United States has certainly done that. There's no question about it. Also helps economically produce all sorts of booms, but also busts and recessions. People get overconfident, so you go up and down. It's a roller coaster, and you see these people that get older. They're so burned out. And they're on the painkillers and of every type. They got pain all over and they're still go, trying to. But at some point they're just like, can't go anymore. But we, here we are, 60, and I haven't even peaked yet. I mean, we're doing these fabulous practices. Water t-shirt with it. Getting better and better and better and better. Not burned out. In shock, yeah. But you need to be very sattvic like this to handle the shock properly. If you're really rajistic, you're going to use this energy, you're going to feel like a jolt, and you're going to turn it into all this frantic doing, frantic competition. Hey, you know, let's have some fun. Are you kidding me? I feel so jazzed up. Instead, we sit here and do nothing and let it gradually dissipate like this. So that takes a very sattvic kind of temperament. So I certainly have made sure my food is that way. The Holy Spirit made sure, and this big push knocked out all that stuff. I've been a vegetarian most of my life. I was born, when I was young, ate some meat. Didn't really like it so much. But we had a really good diet, a lot of vegetables and fruits, fruit juices and all that. My dad was very sattvic and didn't like much meat. We rarely had like steak, for instance, super rare. Had a little bit of ground round beef for hamburgers and tacos and stuff. A lot of fish. We had some fish. But very, very, very sattvic food. It wasn't spicy. It was kind of bland. And so I grew up that way. And then I went vegetarian for a long time. Then for a little while I went back. People that I was around with were not vegetarians. I decided, let me see if I can fit in a little bit here with the times. And I got sick, and I got some Costco chicken that it was just, I got so sick. I said, this is just hideous stuff. It's like eating death. It's so horrible. And forget it. and I stopped. I remember what caused me to really go vegetarian when I was young was I had this like kidney stone or something, or some bile, or maybe the kidney stone, or that was so painful after I ate this really greasy lamb chop, really fatty, oily, greasy lamb chop. It tasted so great, so much salt and stuff. I said, wow, this is great. And somehow it caused, they say if you, sometimes that can cause some sort of kidney stone or something, that, you know, to pass. And it was just the worst pain I've ever experienced. It wouldn't go away. It was just horrible. And I said, you know what? I'm not going to, I don't want to have that pain again. And I'm through with this greasy, fatty meat. And I stopped. I stopped. The pain, the fear of that pain stopped me. So again, that's the grace of God. Pain being used. Fear and pain being used to change your habits. And that certainly worked in my case. So I went vegetarian. I was that way for a long time. Then for a little while, I went off it. And then the last maybe 12 years, I've been vegetarian. So majority of my life, I've been vegetarian. And now I'm even more strict than ever. No peppers again. None of that spicy stuff. I even stopped putting, you know, black pepper on my food. I stopped that. To knock out the rajasic energy, you know, knock that out. That interferes with the spiritual path. It really does. Our path here is based on ability to do nothing, commitment to be able to do nothing. Allow this shock to wear off naturally without pouring it into an attempt to crystallize, fixate the mind. You see, all this doing is an attempt to fixate the mind. So we say, no, 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 no. And a rajasic person say, my gosh, you're wasting your opportunity. I got all this energy. Let's go. Let's fixate the mind. Come on, we can do so much. And of course, that's how you keep going around the wheel of transmigration. So here, we committed to doing absolutely nothing. I'm just sitting here. Let that energy dissipate, the energy of shock dissipate. So again, the rajasic temperament is not suited for the path. They think, oh, you got some way to help fixate the mind? Great. And they interpret it in that regard. So they might be interested, but there's sort of this temporary enthusiasm. They're very enthusiastic, very interested, enthusiastic. And what kind of buzz can I get off of this? You know, what kind of experiences can I have? Man, I want to have some of these experiences, get bells and whistles and stuff. Really, there are very few bells and whistles here. And we don't focus on results. We focus on just practicing, having faith that the results will simply, out of the blue, they'll simply appear as already present. So we have a very sattvic attitude towards it, which is necessary. I don't see how a rajasic temperament can really succeed at all. They just want to go faster around the wheel of transmigration. Thinking that once I fixate the mind, I'll be happy. So I need to go really fast. And they're looking at spiritual stuff as maybe this can help me go fast. It's a completely wrong context that they bring to it. And of course, the cosmic energy, very sluggish, inertial. They can't even generate enough, they can't gather their resolve enough to practice at all. So yeah, maybe someday I'll do it. I just kind of feel, you know, too tired and I just feel sluggish and I can't really see the importance of it or anything. So that doesn't work either. You want the sattvic. Sattvic is aware, focused, gathered resolve, calm, patient, able to sit quietly, able to contemplate, able to look within, not into doing so much, able to not do stuff, able to let stuff pass, all of that. That's what's really helpful. That's what's really helpful. But the autistic temperament is thinks, we're winning. Let's win. Let's go out and win. Come on. Let's go. Let's go. Don't wait. Don't wait. Come on. Press your advantage. Press your advantage. So they're really into pressing their advantage. Whatever advantage they get, they want to leverage it and press it faster and beat someone to the punch. You know, like that. Success. Here is the opposite. We intentionally retreat back from the intensity and then let the shock dissipate. So it's opposite, really, of the autistic temperament. But we don't want to let the sattvic temperament turn into tamistic temperament of sluggish inertia. Okay, that can happen. That can happen. So we're very keen on making sure we practice every day. We don't get lazy. We don't get lazy. Oh wow, we're already at 2:15. Okay. Very great. So there you have it. There you have it. And I'm just going to try and, you know, let this shock dissipate some more through the day, right? And be very sattvic and patient in that way. Don't try to do much too much today after this kind of practice, after this great breakthrough. Happy July 1st, 2017. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. The new way practice is wow.